All right. If I could have your attention, please. Thank you. Does anybody have any questions they'd like to ask before I begin my lecture for today? Any questions about anything that we've covered up till this point in time? Or any problems that anybody's encountering with the readings or the video streaming, the podcasts? All right. So it looks like everything's coming along well for you. And I would again urge you to keep up with the reading because there are texts that are not being covered in the lecture. For example, there's this reading. I just want to actually, you know, talk about that just a little bit for a minute or so that you have some idea as to how to prioritize the readings that you have. So, for example, you know, you had a reading by Thomas Macaulay. It's a long essay on Warren Hastings. And some of you who have actually bothered to do that reading would have surmised that if you read about 20, 25 pages of that, that more or less suffices by way of giving you some idea of the flavor of the text, the nature of, you know, the system of representation that you find there. How is it that, you know, Macaulay is writing about Warren Hastings, and we haven't even actually gotten to him yet because we haven't even really gotten to the Battle of Plassey, and we'll do that shortly, and you certainly will hear about Warren Hastings by the end of the lecture today. But I'm simply saying to you that, you know, for a reading of that kind, unlike, let's say, the Metcalf, which is a very contemporary scholarly account, and, you know, for each week, you're not reading the entire book, but you're reading, let's say, 150, 200 pages from that over a period of 4 to 5 weeks. For a particular week, the reading from the Metcalf might be only, let's say, 40 pages. Now, that kind of reading you probably should do quite seriously because it's a modern scholarly account and it gives you the narrative. And there are times when, obviously, I don't agree with the narrative that a particular writer gives, and I think you'll get some indication of that in my commentary. But something like the Macaulay, unless there are some of you here who are, you know, really interested in Macaulay's literary style and so forth, and of course I'm not saying that you shouldn't read that text in its entirety, but if you're pressed for time, exercise your discretion. You'll see if you read 20, 25 pages, you'll get a pretty good sense of what that text is about. All right, and I think that that's the strategy that you should deploy in this course, particularly when it seems like there are 4 or 5 readings and you're not quite sure how to prioritize these readings. Some of the readings are extremely short when you're looking at primary texts. The letter written by Warren Hastings, you know, as a preface to the translation of the Bhagavad Gita by Charles Wilkins, well, that's only 7-8 pages, and you should obviously read that in its entirety. All right, now, before we turn to the map, let me remind you of where we were and add some further information before we get to this map here and a couple of other maps, the beginnings of British dominion in India, which is, of course, 1757. Recall where we are in the narrative. We're basically in 1756, but and the situation here is that a new Nawab, Nawab is the word for a Muslim ruler, has now come to the throne in Bengal, okay? And when I say Bengal here, I'm referring to, obviously, eastern India, right? So we're talking about this portion over here, okay? This over here is what we're talking about, eastern India, where you can see the arrow. And you see to the west of that, it even says... to the west of that, it says Awadh, that's O-U-D-H, also written as A-W-A-D-H. There are variant spellings for a number of these words. There's a Nawab sitting over there as well. And then if you go further west, right, further west, I mean, this is what you're talking about here, over here is the heartland of the Mughal Empire, and further north here is Kashmir, which is today a disputed territory, disputed between, obviously, Pakistan and India, and towards the very end of this course, you'll hear a little bit about that. And here, to the west of Delhi and Agra, is the Sikh kingdom. It'll be the kingdom of Ranjit Singh later on, not at the moment, but this is where you get the... And this is the states of Rajputana, as I recall, so when you hear about the Rajputs, this is the territory that you're talking about. Gujarat is further south here. This is western India, Bombay, and Surat, and places like that. Okay, and then to the east here is, you see this over here? This is Hyderabad, where the ruler is called the Nizam. He's not called the Nawab. He's the Nizam, and this is an independent kingdom. And when you hear about, in some of the readings, the wars of the Carnatic, so remember that the Carnatic is basically South India, okay? The word has a number of meanings, but it refers broadly to South India. But here what we're really talking about is the wars here in places like Mysore and so on, and eastern, southeastern India here as well. All right, so that's roughly, the geography that you need to be thinking about. Now, we're saying that a Nawab had been installed here in 1756 in Bengal. Okay, new Nawab comes, his name is Siraj-ud-Daulah, a very young person. His predecessor is a man called Aliwardi Khan. And Aliwardi Khan himself was a usurper to the throne. Okay, the picture that I had laid down before you is one of the decline of the Mughals. Okay, so remember 1739, Nader Shah, and I spoke about that at some length. Nader Shah invades India, and the best evidence of the fact that the Mughal Empire is in decline is furnished by the fact that when Nader Shah invades India in 1739 and eventually is going to pillage and sack Delhi. And the two cities that always come to my mind when I think about sacking and pillaging in history, you know, over a period of time. One is Delhi, and to me the other one is Baghdad, you know, constantly sacked and pillaged. All right? So here you have the sack and pillage of Delhi. Nader Shah comes in. Even the short accounts you've read, you know, it's very clear that it's a massacre, essentially. And the Mughal Emperor is virtually powerless to do anything about it. Right? Now, 1756, there's going to be another sacking of Delhi. So 25 years later, the situation for the Mughal Emperor really has not changed very much at all. Except that this time the sacking of Delhi is going to be by Abdali, Ahmad Shah Abdali, who's an Afghan. You know, and again, as a little aside, something for you to think about, because remember what I'd mentioned in my opening lecture. I mean, I at least am aware of the fact, and that's how I teach, that you're all located in the United States. You know, you've grown up with American history, the history of the West, and obviously you have some interest in contemporary affairs, or at least some knowledge of them. You know, American presence in Afghanistan, you know, Iraq, so forth and so on. And of course, Afghans have gotten, let me put it very colloquially, a very bad press in the United States, particularly, you know, after 9/11 and the Taliban and all of that. But at least if you're doing Indian history, there's no question that the Afghans were a major player in the history of India all the way from the early 1000 period onwards up till the 18th century. No question about it. And some of them created magnificent empires, if we could put it this way. All right? So it's something thinking about, you know, how did the history of Afghanistan get to be what it is today, given the fact that Afghans are actually certainly quite important in the history that we're looking at. So here you have Ahmad Shah Abdali, who is going to come into Delhi, pillage and sack the city. He is already controlling, by the way, parts of, let me go to the map here, so just so that you know, he's already controlling Kashmir over here, and Sindh is western India. Today it's in Pakistan after the bifurcation of India, partition of India, 1947. So he already has substantial control of territory. When he comes to Delhi in 1756 to sack the city, he finds that actually Delhi has already been depleted of much of its treasure, and that's partly because of what had happened in 1739 and that whole period over there. All right. The Mughal Emperor, there is a Mughal Emperor throughout. I want to reinforce that idea. It's not that there is no Mughal Emperor. There is a Mughal Emperor there. In fact, the Mughal Emperor during the time of the invasion of Nader Shah is a man called Muhammad Shah. And you don't have to worry, by the way, about all of these names. You're not going to get tested on that, and you can always listen to the podcast to get the names again. Extraordinarily interesting character. In fact, actually, in history, he's known as Muhammad Shah Rangila. Rangila means colorful, somebody who's ever joyous. Because his period is a period which is a period of great patronage of Indian art and music. I mean, what is now known as classical Indian music, particularly Hindustani. Indian classical music has essentially what is called the Hindustani style, and then there's a Carnatic or South Indian style. So what is the North Indian style of classical music, and you know, most of the musicians you would have heard of, Ravi Shankar, Vilayat Khan, all of these, they're basically all North Indian. They all play Hindustani music. This style of music is given much of its form and shape during the reign of Muhammad Shah Rangila. Now, it may well be that he was ignoring his duties as an administrator and as an emperor, and was much more interested in the patronage of the arts. That's certainly how the British put it, that this was one of the reasons why Indian kingdoms began to decline. All right? But you get the picture here. The picture is there's still a Mughal emperor, but he's essentially powerless. Delhi has been sacked in 1739 by Nader Shah, again in 1756 by Ahmad Shah Abdali. In Bengal, okay, Siraj-ud-Daulah has now come to power. Okay, he has succeeded Aliwardi Khan. Yes. Siraj-ud-Daulah. He's in the readings all over. You'll encounter his name repeatedly. Okay, and again, a little footnote: if you don't get all the names, you can also go to Manas, you know, the pedagogic website that I put up, where there are short articles on such things as the Battle of Plassey and so forth, and you'll get all the names over there. All right, okay. So now Siraj-ud-Daulah comes to power. He's a young man, and he essentially is going to make three demands of the British. And the demands are, first, that from his point of view, they have actually put up fortifications which are unauthorized. Okay, remember that the company is not a sovereign power at this point. Yes, it has jurisdiction in its own fort, for example. It has jurisdiction over its own subjects. But at this point, the company doesn't really have any rights except those which have been conferred by the Mughal emperor or by the vassals or the feudatories of the Mughal emperor, right? And the Nawab of Bengal is one of these Nawabs who was a feudatory, a vassal of the Mughal emperor, but he's broken away. He's completely broken away. And of course, when the Nawab of Bengal sees that the Mughal emperor is absolutely helpless against, let's say, Nader Shah, what is he going to do? He's basically going to stop sending revenues to the Mughal emperor. Right, so the situation in 1756 is he's come to power. He's got the Siraj-ud-Daulah. He's got a bit of a problem with the British. He's saying that, look, you have put up fortifications, you put up armaments in Calcutta, which you're not authorized to do. Secondly, you are taking advantage of the firman given, and you have concessions which you are not legally entitled to. Okay. There's certain concessions that they've been given by the Mughal emperor, but he says that, in fact, they are concessions which have not been conferred, which the company is now claiming and demanding, right? And thirdly, that the British are giving refuge to certain dissidents, that is, certain people who are opposed to the Nawab in their territories, for example, the fort. So essentially, this Nawab is going to make these three demands: that these people be returned to him, the company withdraw from certain concessions, and it remove its fortifications. Now, when the British refuse to do that, what Siraj-ud-Daulah is going to do is he's going to basically go up to Calcutta and he's going to take possession of the city. Clive is not in Calcutta at this time. Okay, he's not in Calcutta. He's down south. He's going to be actually called up north now. All right, so he's down south, meaning he's over here in southern India. And remember, Bengal is up over there, right? So he's going to be called there. But before this happens, there's an incident that occurs. I want to spend a few minutes on this incident. It's called the Black Hole of Calcutta. Okay, because what we're interested in is a number of things. First is the question of, quote, What does a standard political narrative look like? Right? What happened in 1756, what happened in 1757, so forth and so on. Secondly, we are interested in how does one discern the truth of history? And is it possible to discern the truth of history? Or do we have to rather go by what we might describe as truth effects? And I'll explain that in just a moment. Right? So that's our second concern. And a third concern, which is related to the second concern, is how does one make an assessment between different competing narratives of a certain phenomenon? All right? So what is the Black Hole of Calcutta? Remember that Siraj-ud-Daulah has made certain demands of the company. The company has refused to oblige, and Siraj-ud-Daulah then sends up an army to Calcutta, right? And he's going to take possession of the city. Now, the Black Hole of Calcutta is an incident which refers to the fact that when he takes possession of the city, he takes a certain number of Britishers, okay, according to this narrative. And what narrative am I talking about now? I'm talking about a narrative written by a man called John Holwell, H-O-L-W-E-L-L. The book is published in 1758. What is the book called? It is called A Genuine Narrative. Listen to the title. A Genuine Narrative of the Deplorable Deaths of the English Gentlemen and Others Who Were Suffocated in the Black Hole. This is the exact title. Published in London, 1758. So what does Holwell say? Holwell says that 146 Britishers, the numbers have varied, by the way. Some people have given, you know, numbers of 120s. Indian historians, to the extent that they think this actually happened. There's some who think that it didn't happen at all. They're a complete fabrication. Okay, but to the extent that some think it actually happened, they say not more than 70 people. Okay, so there's a room by the size of 12 feet by 8 feet. Sometimes the sizes, you know, the size that is given varies again. These English people are taken captive. They're put in this, in the detention cell. Okay? And the following morning, when the door is opened, it seems that the majority of them had perished. There was no air. They suffocate. So that's the title, right? Suffocated to death. And the Black Hole of Calcutta. Now, the interesting thing to bear in mind, and this is what I am particularly interested in. So this is John Holwell, is the person who, writes this narrative. So we are going to call this narrative writer. We're going to just give him assign him a letter. We're going to call him A. And I want to emphasize the fact that this is the only contemporary account we have. The only contemporary account we have. There is, by the way, no Indian account of what happened. Right? Assuming that something happened, and let's go along with the assumption that something did happen. All right? And then there's a question of, well, was the Nawab personally responsible or culpable? Was he aware? Or was it simply, I mean, the Nawab is a ruler, so obviously they're going to be his underlings, right? The people who are working for him, who are obviously, you know, doing things, and whether he was himself knowledgeable about this or not is something that we don't know. Right? Now, and this is 1758, this narrative, although the rumors about the Black Hole of Calcutta were already flying. Now, a year later, someone comes along, okay, and we're going to assign a letter B to that person. Someone comes along and says, well, this is what happened in the Black Hole of Calcutta, and what is my source? My source is A, says B. Now, the year after that, another writer comes along, and we're going to assign him the letter C. Now, what do you suppose C is going to say? Combination of A and B. He's going to say, I've got two sources. My sources are A and B. But remember that B is not a source. B is simply saying what A had written, okay? And then 6 months later, another person comes along who is a commentator, a writer, and we assign him the letter D. And what do you suppose D is going to say?
Now have three sources.
I have three sources. C, okay, plus B, plus A. And, of course, you get all the way down to Z, and then Z, you know, to the power of infinity, right? Let's say 500 writers in, you know, let's say 50 years, or 100 years, or 150 years. And you know what D and E is going to say? I've got four sources. Now, you notice what's happening here, right? This is what is called iteration. repetition. There's only one source, assuming, by the way, that there is that source, by which I mean not that the account was not published, of course it was, but, you know, is it fictitious or not? But we're just saying, let's go with the narrative. Let's go with the narrative. What is certainly very clear. And then we have no reason to believe that the narrative is necessarily true. That's what Holwell is saying. Well, that's Holwell's interpretation of what happened. Right? And this is a very powerful illustration of a phenomenon that you're constantly going to encounter in these texts. And again, I want to suggest to you, do not think for a moment that, oh, this is 18th century, now we are a bit more discreet and wiser about how texts work. I mean, one of my other classes, I gave this example. I mean, there are a few of you here who might remember this or who might, you know, have taken an interest and kept up with it. You know, when the United States went to war, okay, following 9/11, and the idea was that Iraq was also implicated in the attacks of 9/11. We know that Iraq was not even remotely implicated in the attacks of 9/11, right? But this was the attempt of the Bush administration. So what did they do? They came up with the pretext. What was the pretext? Does anybody remember?
Weapons of mass destruction,
WMD. And what was this? Everybody kept on saying Iraq has weapons of mass destruction. Iraq has weapons of mass destruction. To the extent that the Secretary of State for the United States made a special presentation at the United Nations where he purportedly showed that Iraq had weapons of mass destruction. A complete fabrication, if there was one. Now widely conceded by everybody, right? And of course, what are we talking about? We're talking about the fact that once you say it often enough, 50 people join the chorus, 500, thousands, tens of thousands, it becomes true. Once you say something often enough, it becomes true. That's the truth effect. I'm not interested. If somebody came to me and said, hey, I can actually tell you what happened, frankly, I'm not even interested in knowing what happened. And I'm not interested because A, I don't think you can actually say what happened there, and B, it doesn't really matter what happened. What's interesting from the point of view of trying to understand is the truth effect that this incident and its narrative is going to generate. Because this Black Hole of Calcutta narrative is now going to become one of the master narratives that the British are going to use, obviously, to try to understand the nature of Indian society, the perfidy. Look at how deceitful and how treacherous Siraj-ud-Daulah is. And you know, we don't want to be, let me be very clear also, I'm not interested either in a nationalist recuperation of Siraj-ud-Daulah, because as you're going to see in a moment, right, Siraj-ud-Daulah himself is clearly an extremely weak ruler. And one of the reasons why he's going to run into this problem, so to speak, with the British is that he doesn't really know how to make allies. So he's going to alienate the Jagat Sets. These are the bankers I had spoken about last time. He's going to alienate, right, the Mughal Emperor. He's alienated the English. He's even alienated the French. And we'll have a short narrative much later on about the French presence in India and how that's going to be eliminated. That's one of the reasons it's not really important from my standpoint is that, frankly, nobody in India really remembers. And nobody, I mean, even remotely remembers that there was something called the French presence in India, right? But nonetheless, you have to know something about it later on. So now let's get to 1756. So the Black Hole of Calcutta, let's say it occurs. Okay, this is going to be a provocation. Eventually, Clive is going to be sent along with Admiral Watson to go to on a fleet. So they go by sea, and they're going to arrive in Calcutta. And to cut a long story short, in early 1757, Clive is going to be able to repossess Calcutta. But he is looking for a fight. There's no question about that now, because the provocation has occurred, the British have been humiliated, right? And this fight, as it's called, is eventually going to take place on 23rd June 1757 at a mango grove called Plassey. That's the Battle of Plassey. 1757, the conventional point of origin of British rule in India. All right, there are a few other characters who have to be brought into the picture at this point in time. Because one argument that has been made, and again, it's not a nationalist Indian historians who are only making this argument. Number of other writers, you know, for example, a book that I use quite often in my introductory class on Indian history, John Kay, okay, India History, quite an interesting account. I mean, he'll make the same argument that there really was no battle to begin with, because more or less everything was decided before the armies actually assembled. There are armies that are going to assemble at this outside this mangrove grove, okay, on 23rd June 1757. The Nawab has an army. The Nawab here is Siraj-ud-Daulah. He has an army of about 50,000. And the British have an army which is approximately 1/17th or 1/18th that size, 3,000 troops. But they have made an agreement with a man called Mir Jafar. Who is Mir Jafar? Mir Jafar is the commander-in-chief of Siraj-ud-Daulah's army, and he's also a relative of the Nawab. He's an uncle of the Nawab. So essentially, they've told Mir Jafar that, look, if you are able to betray Siraj-ud-Daulah, we will install you as the Nawab of Bengal. You will become the Nawab of Bengal. Right? And Mir Jafar is going to agree. And this is, of course, the interesting question. You know, why was there no conception of national identity or unity in India? You know, is this a scenario that you will frequently encounter in other places too, where Mir Jafar says, "Well, hey, I'm actually ready to betray my own family member just so long as I become the Nawab," right? But in effect, that's what's going to happen. So when the armies actually meet at the battlefield of Plassey, half the troops are going on the Nawab side are going to desert immediately. Many of them are not going to show up. Some of them are going to lay down their armaments. And Siraj-ud-Daulah's army is going to be routed in literally a few hours. Siraj-ud-Daulah himself will run away. He's going to be found dead in a ditch later on. All right? Mir Jafar is going to be appointed the Nawab. Now, when he gets appointed the Nawab of Bengal, there are a number of things he has to do, because of course if the British say that we're going to appoint you Nawab of Bengal, they're expecting something in return, aren't they? I mean, this is not just a gift conferred on Mir Jafar, you know? And what they're expecting in return is that the Nawab is going to relinquish his revenue rights over a certain portion of Bengal. In fact, there are two dozen districts which are immediately handed over to the jurisdiction of the East India Company. When I say handed over to jurisdiction, what I mean is that the East India Company is now going to be collecting the revenue for these 24 districts. They're called the 24 Parganas. They're still called that, by the way, today. If you look at a map of Bengal, the 24 Parganas, that's what they are. These are 24 districts that are ceded, handed over, okay, by Mir Jafar to the East India Company. Clive is optimistic. Why is he interested in getting more revenue? One of the reasons he's interested, apart from the fact that it's going to obviously increase the company's profits, he's hopeful. It doesn't happen that way, but he's hopeful that the companies, remember the trade. The British are taking saltpeter, indigo, textiles, calico, cotton, right? And what are they sending in return? Bullion. They're sending bullion. Clive is hopeful that with the revenues, the company will no longer have to send bullion in return for all of these things. That's what he's hoping. It's not going to work out that way, partly because once the company acquires these districts, okay, and the company's obligations are now going to grow. The company is now becoming a major player. And of course, you know, once you have already tasted that power, you obviously are going to have a quest for more. So the company, to cut again a very long story short, the company is going to find that, well, actually its responsibilities are growing. You know, revenue, the demand for revenue is growing enormously. And in fact, this is going to be a strategy that the British are constantly going to use. They're going to try to, you know, they're going to place people in power, depose them. And usually what they're going to do is they're going to say, well, you know, if you promise to give so much more revenue, we're going to install you as a ruler. This is how they're going to basically shape their alliances. It's a system of alliances here. Private trading is going to increase enormously on the other hand. So this is going to be dipping into the company's revenues, right? Over a period of several years, this arrangement continues. Okay? A few years, this arrangement continues. Mir Jafar is now the Nawab of Bengal. The company's revenues are growing, but the company's need for revenue is also growing dramatically, partly because of expansion. So what they're going to do is, they are eventually going to approach a man called Mir Kasam. Mir Kasam is also related to Mir Jafar and Siraj-ud-Daulah. And so they're going to suggest to Mir Kasam, we will appoint you the Nawab of Bengal, provided you agree to give us more revenue. And Mir Kasam says, I'm going to turn over the revenue rights of Lower Bengal, the lower portion of Bengal, to you. And a few years later, Mir Kasam is then going to be installed as the Nawab of Bengal. Mir Jafar is now deposed. Now you can see, of course, how the nationalist historians in India are going to look at this, and they're going to, looking back at this 150 years later, 200 years, and they're not all necessarily historians, but the person who I want to cite here just for a moment is Jawaharlal Nehru, the person who becomes the first Prime Minister of India, 1947 to 64, right? And he writes this magnificent book called Discovery of India, right? Which is a fast flowing narrative of the entirety of Indian history. Right? And what does he say? He says that Clive won the battle, quote, by promoting treason and forgery. Not a very auspicious rule. Not a very auspicious beginning, I should say, for British rule. Right? Because remember, one of the pillars of British rule in India is going to be the argument that, well, what we bring to India is the sense of fair play. We bring justice. We bring law and order. Right? But what is the origin of this rule? The origin of this rule is obviously, as Nehru is going to say, treason and forgery. And Nehru is not being sentimental and saying, the Indians were, holier than thou. The Siraj-ud-Daulah was a model of good governance. No, nothing of that kind. But what he's registering the fact is that this is a particular problem in Anglo history. And that is that, well, we can say that the Indians and the British, they were all equally susceptible to certain notions of power and greed and so forth. And essentially you could say, if you had to take a simplistic view, it was the law of the jungle and the British prevailed. But the problem with the Anglo view is this constant posturing. We bring law and order, we bring justice, so forth and so on. So for example, if you want to get a very keen sense of what I mean, Macaulay, whose essay on Hastings you're reading, but he also wrote a very long essay on Clive. And this is what he says of Clive. Okay? Remember, Clive is achieving this victory at Plassey in 1757. He says of Clive, quote, that he gave peace, security, prosperity, and such liberty as the case allowed to millions of Indians. Right? Who, for centuries, had been the prey of oppression. Right, you see the contrast, that before Clive comes along, before the British come along, what do you have in India? What you have is despotism, oppression. Okay? But, then you think of it, the cheek of Macaulay. And isn't he aware of how exactly Clive got to be, right, the conqueror of India? No, but you see, all of that is going to be overlooked, because the assumption is that what you really had was a terrain here which was absolutely benefit of law. And now the British are going to bring a certain right notion of law and order, justice and so forth, right? Who for centuries have been the prey of oppression. And now I want to read the second half of the quote, because here's an interesting problem in the study of Indian history. Okay, let me go back to the quote. Macaulay says of Clive that he, quote, gave peace, security, prosperity, and such liberty as the case allowed to millions of Indians, who for centuries had been the prey of oppression, while Napoleon's career of conquest was inspired only by personal ambition and the absolutism he established. So the second half of the quote basically is saying, let's compare Clive with Napoleon. Okay? Because in fact, he's greater than Napoleon. Why is he greater than Napoleon? Because, nothing lasted after that. Napoleon comes along, he's this big dictator, the world worships him, but it's absolutism, right? And he's contrasting Clive with Napoleon. Now, the importance of this contrast is that much of British writings on India are effecting a displacement. By which I mean that they apparently are about India, but they're actually about something quite different. And in this case, what Macaulay is really interested in establishing is exactly what is it that makes the British British. Okay? What makes them British is precisely not only their distinction from Indians, right? Such as Siraj-ud-Daulah and, you know, all the despots that who have been around, but in fact, what makes them British is the fact that even in Europe, there are traditions of absolutism, and the British alone singularly believe in the rule of law. And the rule of law. This is what Macaulay is really trying to establish with this particular quotation. Okay? Now let's go back for a second to the narrative, the political narrative, and finish it up. So Battle of Plassey has taken place. The Nawab has been, Siraj-ud-Daulah is dead. Mir Jafar is brought into power, and then eventually Mir Kasam, okay, is going to be brought into power because Mir Jafar is no longer obliging the British. He's saying that, look, I can't really keep on, you know, getting you the revenue that you want. So they say, well, let's put somebody in power who is going to be a bit more obliging to us. So they put Mir Kasam to power. 3 years later, they are going to throw Mir Kasam out, and they're going to put Mir Jafar back on the throne. Okay? This is Macaulay's great hero that we're talking about, Clive, right, who's orchestrating much of this. Right? And why do they do that? Because eventually Mir Kasam decides, the few years that he is on the throne, before Mir Jafar is brought back from retirement, so to speak, Mir Kasam says that, hey, look, what I'm going to do is I'm going to cut down on the private trading, which I've spoken about. Right? So he tries to cut down on the private trading. He tries to decrease British influence. And even though he is trying desperately to increase the revenue, right, because the British are constantly imposing this demand, he finds that he can't really keep up with it. Right? He's also modernizing his armies. He's modernizing his army, so the British are quite concerned, because if he modernizes his army, well, then he might be in the position to be able to compete, okay, with the East India Company's armies. Right? So in 1763, right, he is going to be now thrown out, and Mir Jafar is going to be restored to power. 1764, you have the Battle of Buxar, it's called. B-U-X-A-R, that's the conventional spelling, Battle of Buxar. What is the Battle of Buxar? Mir Kasam, right, is going to join forces with the Mughal Emperor, Shah Alam. So Mughal Emperor is sitting in North India, but there's still a Mughal Emperor there, right? Shah Alam and the Nawab of Awadh. And who is the Nawab of Awadh? Remember that he's one of these people who is more or less an independent ruler. This is Awadh here. The Nawab of Awadh, Mir Kasam, and Shah Alam are going to combine forces. They're going to meet at the battlefield of Buxar, right? Again, the armies of the Mughal Emperor and the Nawab of Awadh and Mir Kasam combined are much larger than the army of the East India Company. And just so that you don't forget, when I say the army of the East India Company, 7,500 troops in this case, all of them, with the exception of 24 British officials at most, are Indian troops. They're all Indian troops. These are not 7,500 British soldiers that we're talking about. Okay, that's what you have to remember. So these 7,500 sepoys, as they're called, or troops, they have, the person who leads them to victory is not Clive in this case. It's a man called Major Hector Monroe. Okay, and he said, you know, later on, because he was asked, well, how were you able to defeat a force that was much larger than your own force? He says, regular discipline and strict obedience to orders. This is what allowed my army to prevail. Okay, and strict disciplining of mutineers. So there's something that the British are going to do this time, which they're going to repeat in 1857, 1858, as a warning, as an example. Okay, and what do? The troops who mutiny, who say, well, we're not going to follow orders, we're not going to fire on other troops, Indian troops from the other side, they are going to be tied to cannon, okay, and then they put the ball in the cannon and they fire it, and the body, of course, flies into the air and is blown into thousands of bits of pieces. 24 mutineers are going to be blown to bits. This is something they're going to do again, and as I said, in 1857, 1858. Right? So this is essentially what we're speaking about when we're talking about the origins of British rule in India, 1757, Battle of Buxar, 1764. Now, in the aftermath of 1764, the emperor is going to award what is called the Diwani. The Diwani is the right to collect the revenue, okay, on behalf. Now, remember that it's not that the British have always been getting revenues, right? But they are getting it from Mir Jafar, Mir Kasam, so forth and so on, right? Now they become the Diwani collectors, by which I mean that the Nawab has essentially been eliminated as a middleman. Now they are dealing directly with the Mughal Emperor. Okay, and how much of the revenue they're going to transmit to the Mughal Emperor, if any, so forth and so on, this is obviously a matter that, you know, we would have to take up for consideration as we keep on moving on from the 1760s, going into the 1770s, and thereafter. All right? And just to finish up with Clive, and because there's a speech that he's going to make, which again, I find to be really quite astounding. All right? So Clive is going to be in India. Right, for several years after Plassey, he's going to go back to Britain. When he goes back to Britain, he's extremely wealthy. He's extremely wealthy because he's acquired a huge personal fortune in India. You're going to hear a little bit more about that just for in a second. He is given a Clive. He's given a title. He now becomes Baron Clive. Okay, he's eventually going to be knighted, and he's going to try to enter into politics. What he's going to do also when he's in Britain is he is now going to try to have an influence in the affairs of the company from London. Okay, because he's shifted his... He's eventually going to be called back to India. This is his third trip back to India. He's going to be called back a few years later because they're going to find that the company's finances are suffering enormously. All right? And they think that, well, Clive is a person who might be able to reinvigorate the company, resuscitate it, so forth and so on. So he goes back to India for a short period, and then finally he's back in Britain again. In 1772, Clive, there is going to be a parliamentary inquiry into corrupt practices by Clive and others. A parliamentary inquiry. And the passage I want to read out, because I think it gives you an extremely good flavor of how Clive is thinking of his own role. I mean, he is thinking of himself as a person who has essentially handed over India to Britain, right? A place that's going to become the crown jewel. Right? This is, and he's obviously thinking of highly his own, you know, role in the most exaggerated terms that you can possibly think of. Now, when this parliamentary inquiry takes place in 1772, and he's charged with having indulged in corruption and so forth, this is a speech he makes before the House of Lords. Okay, I'm quoting. A great prince was dependent on my pleasure. So he's speaking here about the Nawabs of Bengal. Okay, an opulent city lay at my mercy. Is this Calcutta? You know, the wealth of Bengal in general lay at my feet, at my mercy. Its richest bankers bid against one another for my smiles. I walked through vaults which were thrown open to me, okay, alone, piled on either side with gold and jewels. So there's actually this film which was made in the US, if you can get your hands on it, a bit hard to find, called Clive of India, 1935. And there's this amazing scene in this film where after the Battle of Plassey, and Mir Jafar says, okay, Clive, he brings Clive into the treasury, and there's this room, and there's no room to walk because it's studded with jewels, rubies, diamonds, and Mir Jafar says to Clive, take what you want, right? So this is what he's referring to here. So, okay, I walked through vaults which were thrown open to me alone, piled on either side with gold and jewels. Mr. Chairman, at this moment, I stand astonished at my own moderation. At this moment, I stand astonished at my own moderation. I could have taken millions of pounds of jewels. I only took 300,000 pounds. You know, why are you accusing me of corruption? Look at how modest I was. Right? This is Clive. And so, of course, he's going to be acquitted. You know, everybody's charmed by him. And in 1774, Clive will commit suicide. That's another story. I wrote a little piece, by the way, which I'm just going to recommend because that's not the kind of piece that professional historians write at all or even bother thinking about. But it's a very interesting little story because it makes you think about, you know, the extravagant claims that people make for themselves, how they think they're immortal, so forth and so on. Clive was given a pet tortoise, okay? And I don't know how many of you know that there are some tortoises that can live up to 250 years. 250 years is their lifespan. So he was given an Aldabra tortoise who just passed away 10 years ago. This was Clive's pet tortoise. I'm serious. Okay, so I wrote a little piece. It's called The Thief, His Pet, and so forth and so on. The thief refers to Clive. Because, of course, you know, the tortoise lived to see the end of British rule, right? He lived to see the end of British rule. So you sort of look at it from the point of view of the tortoise. That, I mean, here I am. I'm sort of, you know, majestically sitting on, you know, on the beach, soaking in the lovely sun. And here's Clive, you know, rotten life, eventually commits suicide, right? Because remember, what was the British Empire? What was the phrase for it? The sun never sets on the British Empire. That was a phrase. It never sets on the British Empire. Right? So there are different ways in which you make an assessment of the claims of people, the claims of events to be earth-shaking, so forth and so on. I mean, the long run of things, we have to take a very different perspective on how all of this really matters. All right. So that's the end of Clive. Now let's shift back to India for a moment. Okay, and I want to just here look at this map here, and then we'll get rid of the screen. Okay, so I've already gone over this particular map with you here. So here, this map is called India in the time of Clive, okay, 1760. So you, here's Awadh again. This is now Bengal. And here, you know, this portion over here, this is where you've got, you know, Hyderabad and so on, okay? The British have a tremendous influence in this part here as well. This is the southeast coast over here. All right, if these maps, by the way, you can find on the internet, what they're going to show you is, you know, the expansion of British territories in India over a period of time. All right, so we're going to just dispense with this now. And let me get back now to India in 1760s and thereafter. Okay. Now, number of significant changes. So 1765, the British have acquired the right to Diwani. However, Clive is going to persist in a certain kind of fiction. A certain kind of fiction by which I mean that the idea of a shadow government or a double government is something that he is going to live with. And in order to explain what that means, I want to quote from something that he wrote later on. We are sensible, says Clive, that since the acquisition of the Diwani, remember what is a Diwani? The right to collect the revenues, right? Okay? The power formerly belonging to the Subha of these princes is totally, in fact, vested in the East India Company. Okay? The power that formerly belonged to the Nawab is now vested in the East India Company. We have that power now. We are fully aware of that, he says. Nothing remains to him but the name and shadow of authority. Okay, so there's this Nawab, but he's just a puppet figure. There's a name, there's nothing there. Nothing else, right? He's a paper tiger. This name, however, the shadow, it is indispensably necessary, okay? And we should seem to venerate it. Now, this is a very interesting argument that he's making. What he's saying is that, look, there's just no question that the company has now become supreme in Bengal. right? That's a reality. The Nawab has absolutely no power. He's a paper tiger. But we still want to go along with this idea that, yeah, there is a Nawab, he matters. There is a Mughal emperor, he matters. So forth and so on, right? And we, in fact, it should look like we are venerating these people, right? We are venerating them, giving them respect and so forth and so on. Why is it indispensably necessary? Because what Clive is thinking about is, what is the future of British rule in India? How are we going to secure this rule? He is already aware of the fact that what you have is you've got a very rapid transition that has taken place. Okay? It's extremely rapid transition that has taken place, and it is, in a sense, creating a certain kind of political and social disorder in that society. So one of the ways in which you try to make the position stable, because a company will only flourish under conditions of stability. Right? If the company has to deal with constant disorder, what it's going to do, obviously, is going to make demands, because then you have to control that disorder. That means you have to assign troops. To assign troops, you have to have then greater revenues, so forth and so on. So what he's saying is that let's maintain this fiction of a shadow government. Okay, and this fiction is going to be maintained for a certain period of time. All right. Now, there are a number of other actors. We're going to just put that aside for a moment because I want to come to, you know, Warren Hastings, to the establishment now of British rule, not in the political sense, not that is with respect to the political history of what happened. What are the institutional changes that are going to take place? Okay, one of the concerns now that the British are going to have, right, and we're moving now into the 1770s, and so you're going to actually have two major pieces of legislation in 1773 and 1774. All right, and what are these pieces of legislation amount to? What they amount to is they want, these pieces of legislation are designed to make the company more responsible to Parliament. That's the intent of these. Because what the company is now becoming a major affair. It has now become a power in Asia, right? And there are people sitting in Britain, people involved in politics. When I say people sitting in Britain, I'm talking about Parliament here, who are saying that, look, the company is becoming a power unto itself. It's becoming a power unto itself. We need to find some way to regulate this company. Okay? And so that's what these pieces of legislation, Lord North's Regulating Act, for example, of 1773, are designed to do. All right, they are designed to streamline the administration, make the company more responsible. All right, and I want to, at this juncture here, then to give you some idea of what is going to be the structure of the company. So here you've got the East India Company, okay, and they have what is called a board of control. So this board of control is going to be a consequence of this, these pieces of legislation that I'm talking about. Okay, and then it has what is called the Court of Directors. All right. So the Court of Directors, by the way, is a body of people who are essentially large stockholders in the company. And then you have a Board of Control. This Board of Control comes about as a consequence of these changes. What does the Board of Control seek to do? What it seeks to do is, as the title should indicate to you, Board of Control. I mean, it's pretty blatant, right? It seeks to actually impose some control on the company, regulate its affairs, make it more responsible to Parliament. All right? And incidentally, you have to keep in mind, so what is the structure, by the way, in India? I don't know if anybody here remembers. You've got the presidency structure, remember? So you've got the three presidencies. You've got the presidency of Bengal, the presidency of Madras, right? And the presidency of Bombay in Western India. Each of these has a governor. Now there's going to be a governor general of India. So far there's been no governor general. Warren Hastings is going to be the first governor general of India. And he's going to have a fairly long term as governor general of India. All right. The governor general of India is also the governor of Bengal, because at this point in time, the British capital is going to be based in Bengal. And Calcutta is going to become the capital. Right? Murshidabad used to be the capital of the Nawabs, but the British are going to establish a capital eventually in Calcutta, right? And that's going to remain the capital until the early part of the 20th century, when the British are going to announce a shift to Delhi, and they're going to build this new imperial capital in Delhi. Obviously, something we'll get to much later on. All right? So According to these pieces of legislation, there's going to be a governor general, and the three governors are actually going to report to him. Well, he's also the governor of Bengal, so he's acting in dual capacity. At some point, you're going to find that the office is going to be split. Okay, it's going to be bifurcated. So the governor general is now going to have a council. So that's, and so when he sits in council, he's called the governor general in council. And a council can be looked upon as a kind of a cabinet. So there are going to be members of the council, member for, you know, law, for example, you know, internal administration, in the 19th century railways, for example, is going to be exceedingly important, so forth and so on. All right? The Board of Control is a small body of people who essentially formulate the company's policy. Okay? They formulate the company's policy, but there are decisions that have to be approved by the court of directors. So what they're doing is they're introducing a larger number of bodies, right? And they're introducing a larger number of bodies here because essentially what they're trying to make sure is that there's some kind of checks and balances within the system, that the company does not really get to be too powerful. All right, and this is going to be a constant tussle, by the way, after the 1770s between the company and Parliament and the Crown. All right, because they, as I said, they want to make sure that the company does not really exceed the powers that have been allotted to it. Now, when policy is made, so let's say that you are the governor of Bengal, you're sitting over here, so governor of Bengal, and you need to decide what policy is on a certain matter, right? So what do? You transmit a letter. Remember that the letter is going by sea in the 18th century, right? It's a long voyage. The letter is going to come to the East India Company, and it's going to go to what is called the Office of Correspondence. The Office of Correspondence, and there's an Examiner of Correspondence. And then underneath him are a number of writers. So these are people who are basically, you know, writing up the policy documents. And what do I mean when I say a policy document? When British rule is expanding, one of the things they're going to do is they're going to absorb little kingdoms, right? So initially you've got British rule over here, and you've got British influence over here, you've got some British influence over here, okay? And these are the states of Rajputana. Now, we are talking about hundreds of states in Western India, small states, independent states, right? As British rule expands, they decide that they want to absorb. Let me use an uglier word than absorb. Annex. Annexation. They want to basically take over a kingdom and merge it into their territories. All right? Now, when they decide to do that, before they do that, they say, okay, this is what our policy is going to be, and what is going to be the pretext for taking over this state? By the 19th century, the pretext argument is important. That is that, because remember that on the one hand, the British have this rhetoric. And the rhetoric is, remember that quote from Macaulay, that Indians have for centuries been the prey of oppression. Now, for the first time in their history, they're going to get law and order. But if they're going to get law and order and you simply walk over them, well, that doesn't look very nice, does it? Right? So there has to be a pretext. I'm sort of jumping the ship a little bit here because I'm trying to explain to you how the structure, okay, works, right? So the pretext, for example, in the 19th century is going to be, give you two pretexts, right? One is what is called the doctrine of lapse, L-A-P-S-E, doctrine of lapse. When an Indian ruler does not have a biological heir to the throne, okay, the British are going to say, we're going to take over. Okay. By the way, in all of these places, let's supposing that you are, you know, the king of a little place. You have a little kingdom. You know, you do not produce a biological heir to the throne. So under Hindu law, you adopt the child. You adopt a child, and that child is considered under Hindu law to be the rightful heir to the throne. The British did not recognize such adoptions. So this is what is called the doctrine of lapse, that because there is no natural heir to the throne anymore, this kingdom has now ceased to exist. It has lapsed. Okay? The other pretext, which is commonly used for annexation, is the argument that a native ruler is insensitive to his own subjects. That is, now let's put it in more brutal language, he's oppressing and tyrannizing his own subjects. See, right? And we cannot sit here. This is, you've heard this argument, in international affairs it takes place all the time. You know, Syria is abusing, you know, the leader of Syria is abusing his own people, should we just sit aside and do nothing? It's the same argument, more or less. I mean, there are variations of it. Okay? Except that, of course, nobody's thinking of absorbing Syria, but, you know, that's a difference there. Now, what you would do here is, you would say, the native ruler is unjust to his subjects, and we, as the paramount power, so this is what is called the doctrine of paramount power, that we are the supreme power. As a paramount power, we have a moral obligation to intervene. All right? And so you take over. However, before any of these places are taken over, they are going to go through this whole set of discussions. Because, of course, if a ruler has been abusing his people for decades, you've got correspondence going on for decades, right? So when I say correspondence, the governor of Bengal, and of course there'll be some official working under him, he will send a document which will then come to the office of the examiner of correspondence. Right? He'll send a document saying, well, this is what's happening in Kingdom A, and what do you think we should do? Okay? This is what we are inclined to do, but we would like to get orders from the company's offices in London. And then the company will write back and say, well, we need more information. Now, this could go on for years. You could have, you know, I've read some of these files. They run into hundreds of pages, okay, each file, right, where there's back and forth going on between these officials, all right, and somebody in the office of the examiner of correspondence is in charge of this correspondence for this particular matter. It so happens to be the case, a little footnote of great importance here, by the way, you know, but the person who is dealing with all of this in the early 19th century, first half of the 19th century, is John Stuart Mill. Okay? He is going to write the documents which are going to justify hundreds of annexations by the British of Indian territory. Remember John Stuart Mill, the great philosopher of liberty, right? Writes an essay called On Liberty, for which he's exceedingly well known. Right? So that's what Mill is doing, John Stuart Mill. He is working in the office of the examiner of correspondence. His father, James Mill, also worked in the office of the examiner of correspondence. Those of you who remember Ron Inman's article will remember there's a discussion of James Mill, because James Mill writes his huge work called History of British India. All right? This is roughly what we're talking about as a structure. You have of course, the company has other, you know, divisions and so forth and so on. We're not interested in all of that. We're interested in basically in the court of directors, the board of control, the office of the examiner of correspondence, and the fundamental relationship with India there. Now, of course, you don't have only the three presidency. As British rule continues to grow, one of the things that's going to happen is that there are going to be other establishments within British India. So, for example, Delhi is going to be under a lieutenant governorship. It's not part of the three presidencies. Okay, but Delhi is not obviously going to be absorbed, so to speak, into British India until much later on. All right. Now, before Warren Hastings is going to be asked to take over as Governor General, something else happens in India, which I want to spend a few minutes on. Something which a lot of historians, even very good historians, and even those who I think have a largely sympathetic account, you know, Kay is, I think, a very good example. I mean, I think this history is a pretty good history, all things considered. But the phenomenon that I'm about to describe, he gives literally two lines to it. And that is the Great Bengal Famine of 1769-70. 13 years after Plassey. This famine commences late 1769, continues until 1773. 3.5, 4 years, 10 million people dead. 10 million. Again, a figure about which there is frankly really no dispute today. Yeah, it doesn't matter which school of thought you belong to. You know, whether you're a conservative historian, a Marxist historian, liberal historian, that's pretty much agreed. Of course, there are differences of interpretation as to what accounted for the famine. Okay, who's responsible for the famine? Approximately 30% of the population of Bengal is wiped out. Wiped out. 30%. Okay, and when I say Bengal here, I have to say that, I'm not speaking just about modern Bengal. Today it would include West Bengal, the state of Bihar, Bangladesh, okay, even eastern India over here, the state of Orissa, okay? The state of Orissa, also spelled this way before. Parts of that, this is all included in this area that I'm calling Bengal, okay? 10 million people die. Now, what were the reasons for the famine? Number one, why should we be thinking about it other than the fact that, well, it's 10 million people died in it? And one of the reasons we should be thinking is that, to be quite blunt about it, British rule in India is bookended by famines. Okay, if you had to think about, you know, what did British rule leave behind in India? I mean, you recall what I mentioned to you about life expectancy. That in 1900, life expectancy in India was 19.2. All right? And there is no question that the entirety of British rule in India is marred by famines. So it begins with this huge famine, and it ends with what is called the Great Bengal Famine of 1943. 1943, World War II is going on at this point in time. And you have 3 million people who are going to die in Bengal on account of this famine. And when 3 million people die in Bengal in 1943, it's not because there is a shortage of food. In fact, the most well-known scholar of famines, Amartya Sen, okay, who's written enormously on this subject, right? Amartya Sen's basic finding, number one, is that famines are almost never caused actually by shortages of food. They are caused by shortages of entitlement, by which he means very simply that people do not have access to the money or the means to be able to buy food. Okay? Now, of course, there may be areas where you don't have an adequate supply, but this is why you've got, you know, various kinds of communication networks that you send, for example, food from one area to another area. In fact, this was going to become a great justification that the British were going to have for the introduction of railways in India, that one of the things that the railways will do is it will enable us to send food quickly from one area to another, from an area that has a surplus to an area that has a shortage of food. Okay, this idea that famines are natural is entirely incorrect. They are almost always man-made. Almost always. And one of the arguments that Amartya Sen made, and I think he's right on this score, is that you do not find famines in democracies. India, since 1947, since it became a sovereign republic, has not had a famine. Now, I'm the last person to say that there's no problem of malnutrition. There is. There's an enormous number of people in India who are suffering from malnutrition, but there is a difference between malnutrition and famine. And you do not have the kind of famine that you have had in India under British rule. There is a book which is not just on famines in India, it's basically on famines and the relationship with being colonized. It's a fantastic book written by Mike Davis called Late Victorian Holocausts. You should have a look at it, okay? Late Victorian Holocausts, because that's what it was. It was a Holocaust, the famine of 1769 to 1773. 10 million people, that's more than the number of people who died in the Holocaust, okay, in Europe. Think about it this way, all right? If you had to sort of come up with comparative figures. Now, what were the causes for the famine? Number one, absolute dereliction of duty by company officials. There's no question about it. There are reports that are being sent to British officials talking about the fact that there are people who now do not have access to food and they're falling off like flies. And company officials are going to actually ignore these reports. That's cause number one, all right? there is a drought that takes place in 1769, but the following year you have ample rainfall. You have ample rainfall. So this is not going to explain entirely, you know, why you, it might even explain the origin, but it would not explain why the famine continues over a period of 3 or 4 years. Number two, the British demand for revenue, the taxes that they were now imposing, is actually going to be increased during the famine years. Usually what you do when you have a famine is you say that I'm going to relinquish the demand. I'm going to decrease it. So if you put a land tax, or for example, tax on agriculture had gone up from, land tax had gone up from 10% to 50%, okay, by the time of the famine of 1769, 1770. So over a period of a decade, you've got an enormous increase in land tax. And actually in April 1770, when the famine has now already been on for 6 months, the company, because it's still the company here, the company actually announces a further increase of 10%, okay, in the land tax. So what that does, of course, is it places an enormous burden on the peasantry. Thirdly, okay, so these three are the main causes. Thirdly, the destruction of traditional forms of agriculture and their replacement by cash crops. So, for example, an insistence that you grow not for yourself or for the local market, you actually grow for a global market. In this case, what is it going to be replaced by, you think? If you remember the opium wars, opium poppy, right? Destruction of the traditional food crops and traditional methods of farming. So replacement of rice, for example, by indigo, which is a dye. Okay? Replacement of food crops by opium poppy. And this is going to create absolute havoc. 1765, just to give you an idea what the company's profits were, 1765, 15 million, 1777, 30 million. They've doubled. So the company is certainly raking in profits. There's no question about that, right? And the famine, I'm suggesting to you, is certainly one of the things that we have to take note of when we're looking at, you know, what is the kind of assessment that we would make of British rule in India. You know, did it benefit the country? You know, and there's still some people who used to, you know, who are still looking at that question. And frankly, I don't think that this question really needs to be looked at all. But nonetheless, if you had to look at the question, then I think you would have to look at some considerations of this kind. Now, Warren Hastings, so we're in the 1770s now. Warren Hastings is going to come to India as the Governor General, the first Governor General of India. And he's going to serve a term that is going to be in excess of 10 years. Okay. Now, what is Warren Hastings' governor generalship characterized by? That's the general, we need to get a general idea of that. We're going to look at some particulars of it in my next lecture, but just a broad idea. Okay. First, he's going to remove this fiction of a shadow government that Clive had, right? This idea that, well, we're still going to pay obeisance of some kind. We're going to venerate in principle. Okay, the outward symbols of authority of native rulers, Warren Hastings is going to do away with that completely. Okay, in other words, the Nawab is going to be completely stripped of power, and there's going to be no attempt now to suggest that, well, yeah, you know, this figurehead called the Nawab. In fact, actually, of course, what Warren Hastings is going to do, and he's going to, in a way, set the precedent for people who are going to follow him, is that you're now going to start dealing with the Mughal emperor in the same fashion. Okay. But this is going to be an interesting bone of contention, because there are going to be governor generals all the way until the 1830s, 1840s, who are going to say that, well, the Mughal emperor is still sitting there, okay, and we ought to at least in principle venerate him as the sovereign of India, the king of India. Okay? But of course, what's happening is that the Mughal emperor's jurisdiction and his authority is going to be year by year absolutely stripped. Right? So there's really nothing there, in a manner of speaking. But nonetheless, you continue to maintain the outward signs of respect for the Mughal emperor. Okay? I'll try to get to your question a moment, because I want to just finish this. Okay? Secondly, okay, the tribute to the company is withdrawn. The tribute to the East India Company, Warren Hastings is going, we're not going to pay any tribute, not to the company, sorry, tribute to the emperor. Mughal emperor is going to be withdrawn. All right? So this is related to the first point, namely that the Mughal emperor's power is slowly being stripped. Okay. Thirdly, Warren Hastings has to deal with a group of people, okay, that have been around. You've heard about the Marathas. So he's going to try to find ways to control the Marathas. Remember that the Marathas are based in Western India, right? But they have been now a power for, you know, 100 years. Okay, and they have launched raids all the way into Bengal. They have sacked Delhi on a number of occasions. So the Marathas are a fairly considerable fighting force. And one of the ambitions that Warren Hastings is going to have is going to be able to try to contain the Marathas. He's not going to be entirely successful in that, and it's not going to be actually until the early 19th century that the British are going to be able to finally deal with the Marathas. Now, in an attempt to deal with people like the Marathas, what Warren Hastings is going to do is he's going to forge a system of alliances. Again, not something that is entirely novel to him, because what was Clive doing? In a manner of speaking, that's what he was doing. I'm going to forge an alliance with Mir Jafar against Siraj-ud-Daulah. I'm going to forge an alliance with Mir Kasam against Mir Jafar, right? But what I'm speaking about here is more geopolitical alliances, not just within an area. So, you know, you say that, well, I want to contain, for example, the ruler of Mysore, okay, over here, Hyder Ali. We'll get to him in the next lecture. A major force, the British have to deal with him. So what Warren Hastings is going to attempt to do is forge a system of alliances to contain regional powers such as the ruler of Mysore. Okay? In order to fund some of these activities, he has to borrow heavily. And who does he borrow from? Because the revenues of the company are not enough for these wars of expansion. Essentially, what we're saying is that he is now slowly thinking about expanding British rule in India. So that's what I mean by these wars of expansion. He's going to borrow heavily from other Indian rulers, such as, for example, the Raja of Banaras. Okay, Banaras is in the Gangetic Plains. The Begums of Awadh, the Begums are these, you know, queens, okay, of Awadh, a place that you saw on the map. All right? So these are some of the activities he's involved in. I want to add one further thing to it, and then we'll stop for today. And that is that Warren Hastings is also a considerable patron of Indian learning. He's interested in the intellectual, spiritual, cultural legacy of this civilization. Okay, so one of the short texts that you're going to read is at the Bhagavad Gita, which is one of the major texts, right? There is going to be a translation done of the Bhagavad Gita by a person who's working for the company. His name is Charles Wilkins. And Warren Hastings is going to write the preface to that introduction. So we're going to look at that preface on Thursday. All right?